Recorded Books presents a Griot Audio production. Up at the College by Michele Andrea Bowen. This unabridged recording is narrated by Shari, Peele. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Michele Andrea Bowen. This recording is copyrighted 2009 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Griot Audio, celebrating the best in contemporary African-American fiction and nonfiction.
Prologue. Yvonne sat on the floor, surrounded by the boxes crowding up the living room, wishing she had said yes instead of no when her parents asked if she wanted them to come up to Richmond and help with the packing. The movers were coming in 3 days, and Yvonne felt like she could use 6. She didn't want to move out of her home, but she had to, because Daryl, her soon-to-be ex-husband, had threatened to fight her for custody of their 2 daughters if she didn't take the girls and get out of their home by a certain date. Nobody who heard this story could believe that a man would put his wife and children out of their own home based on the bogus assumption that this house was his, simply because Yvonne was an at-home mom when they bought it. The doorbell rang. "Who is it?" Yvonne spat out, and then kicked a half-filled moving box, hurting her toe. The doorbell rang again, this time followed by loud and insistent knocking. Didn't this person hear her say, "Who is it?" Yvonne thought, as she snatched the door open, ready to flip off on whoever was on the other side. Her angry glare met the bewildered expression of the young lady cradling a crystal vase filled with 3 dozen velvety pink roses. "Mrs. Copeland?" the young woman asked in a kind and soothing voice. "Yes," Yvonne said, her voice a whole lot softer. "These are for you." "Me?" Yvonne raised an eyebrow, wondering who thought she needed a vase full of expensive pink roses when her budget was so tight. "Yes, these are for you," the young woman answered and put the vase in Yvonne's hands. "Come on in," Yvonne said over her shoulder as she put the vase on top of the white baby grand piano and turned to sign for the flowers. "You have a beautiful home, Mrs. Copeland." All Yvonne could do was nod. The house was very beautiful, but it wasn't her home anymore. She said, "Do you have a pen?" The young woman reached into the bag on her shoulder and put a pale pink envelope into Yvonne's outstretched hand. "They are not paying me enough for this," she thought, watching Yvonne trying to figure out what in the world was going on. "These flowers are not from the florist. My boss, your husband's lawyer, was instructed by Dr. Copeland to deliver your separation agreement and these flowers to you." Yvonne couldn't believe Daryl. Today was Valentine's Day, and he knew how much she loved Valentine's Day. It was like he was doing everything in his power to hurt her as badly as he could. She felt the weight of the envelope and tried not to admire the exquisite, fine linen stationery in her favorite color. "Valentine's Day," Yvonne kept thinking as she whispered. "Why me?" "Mrs. Copeland, are you all right?" "Yeah, I'm fine," Yvonne answered as she struggled to blink back hot tears. She had been prepared for hurt, surmising that she couldn't get through a divorce without some casualty of the heart, but she didn't know it would be this bad. The young woman had never met Yvonne, but she knew that in her worst moment, Mrs. Copeland had never done anything to be treated like this by her husband and the father of her children. Tears streamed down Yvonne's cheeks as she stared into the kind blue eyes of this unlikely bearer of bad news.
"Mrs. Copeland, I could get fired for saying this to you, but you have to know that any man who treats you with such disregard
is not worth your tears. I pray that the day you leave this house, you will step out on faith, trust God, and never look back." Yvonne sat down on one of the moving boxes. She put her face in her hands and sobbed. The young lady sat down and put her arm around Yvonne's shoulders. "I know you might not feel this right now, but God is on your side, and He will see you through this storm." Yvonne nodded. See her through. How many times had she heard those words in the past few months? As far as she was concerned, God seeing her through this disaster was a pretty tall order. Here she was, a well-educated, 43-year-old black woman with two daughters, unemployed, forced to leave a home she didn't think she'd ever be able to buy again, and crying on the shoulders of a blonde, blue-eyed white woman who looked like the worst problem she'd ever had was being a day late paying her rent, simply because she had forgotten to post a reminder on her calendar. The young lady reached into her bag and pulled out a baby blue suede Bible. She turned to the first chapter of Luke and found verse 37. "You know," she said, "it says right here that nothing is impossible with God. Not only is He going to see you through all of this, He is going to create for you cause to give a wonderful testimony about the glory of the Lord. And whenever it feels like it can't get any worse, you just remember that nothing, absolutely nothing, is impossible with our God." "Thank you," Yvonne whispered, thinking that she was experiencing one of those "it can't get any worse" moments right now. "I'll let myself out," the young lady said as she got up and walked to the door. By the time Yvonne's 3 days were up and February 17th, moving day, rolled up on her, Yvonne was ready to transform this season in her life into a "gone are the things of the past" event. She walked through the house, making sure that all of her boxes were in place, and came upon the last unsealed box, pulled back the flaps, and peered inside at the worn white satin wedding album. It was obvious that Darryl had tossed the album into the box, apparently hoping to convey that he didn't want any reminders of her in this house. "I wonder if he plans on tossing the girls in a box too," Yvonne mused. She pulled the wedding album out of the box and stared at Darryl's thin, solemn face on what was supposed to have been one of the happiest days of her life, wondering why the boy had ever formed his mouth to ask her to marry him. Even during their best times together, Darryl always found something wrong with Yvonne. Throughout their marriage, he lectured her relentlessly on what he contended was her tendency to act like a simpleton, marred even more so by her country ways and mannerisms. She stared at herself a moment, wondering why the pretty 20-something in the picture, with yards and yards of delicate lace trailing behind her, didn't have the sense to bunch up that dress and run. She couldn't help but think about the day Darryl came home and announced, "After much contemplation, relentless journaling to soothe my endless vexation with you, Tai Chi, acupuncture, and colon cleansing to rid myself of the impurities brought on by my anxiety over this situation, I have decided that I must find my way back to my original self through a wrenching detachment process some refer to as a divorce. And please, turn off that clamor," he snapped, referring to the music on her CD player. "I can barely hear myself think above all that rump-shaking, bass-thumping garbage." "Darryl," Yvonne said evenly, "this is a Jonathan Nelson CD, and he is a gospel singer." Darryl snorted in disgust. He disliked gospel music even more than he did hip-hop and rhythm and blues. "You want to sit down?" "No," he answered. "I prefer to stand." "Okay, suit yourself." That's the problem with you, Yvonne, he snarled. You are so simple. I mean, look at me. I've spent years earning a PhD in exotic agricultural studies, done postdoctoral studies all over the world, and I continue to expand my intellect in every possible way. But you, Daryl snorted in disgust, you are content to walk around grinning over the smallest and most insignificant matter. You are enamored with R&B and gospel music, but rarely do you want to listen to anything that expands your mind. I have yet to walk into this office and hear something worthwhile, like the Brahmin folk shamans. Yvonne wasn't going to dignify that comment with a response, even though she had plenty to say on the matter. The one time she tried to listen to a song by that group just to please Daryl, the leader's voice, which was weird, gave her a splitting headache. He sounded just like Chewbacca from Star Wars. She stared at Daryl for a moment and thought about going off on him and putting him out of her office. But she heard a soft voice in her spirit whispering, "Get still and be quiet." Neither said a word. The longer they were silent, the more peaceful Yvonne became, even though her husband's agitation escalated with each passing second. When Daryl finally spoke again, he was so mad for a moment he literally forgot how to unclench his teeth. His words came hissing out. "We've been together a total of 16 years, and it feels like an eternity spent betwixt and between heaven and hell. I want you and the girls out of my house 7 weeks from today. And here are the terms of our pending separation," he said as he tossed a heavy envelope at her feet. Yvonne was stunned. She didn't know that her husband, her baby's daddy, felt this way about her. Oh, she knew that Daryl was going through something. He was always going through some kind of dramatic episode. But this was something beyond the usual, "Daryl is going through something or another." This was a carefully planned kill, steal, and destroy mission. When Daryl stormed out of her office that day, it was the end of her marriage and life as she'd known it over the past decade. Yvonne remembered sitting at her desk, staring at the ocean screensaver on her computer until she got bored enough to initiate the excruciating process of putting her shattered life back together. Even now, Yvonne marveled at all the things she didn't do or didn't say. Whenever she relayed the story to family or a close friend, they'd all say the same thing. "Girl, you mean to tell me that he said all of that and you didn't yell, get to cussing, cry until snot ran down into your mouth, put sugar in his gas tank, smear his car with creamed corn, send nasty emails to his boss, or open up a bunch of magazine subscriptions in his name?" "Nope," was all Yvonne had said. As much as she had wanted to do all of the above and then some, she hadn't been able to do anything but ask the Lord to provide her with protection in the midst of this raging storm, a Holy Ghost umbrella that wouldn't bend back and be ripped out of her hands by a particularly harsh and bitter wind. Yvonne dropped the wedding album on the floor, stepped on it, and then kicked it across the room. She sealed the box and went through the house one last time before the movers were scheduled to arrive. When she was sure that all was in order, Yvonne went into the kitchen and made herself a big, fat, simple, country, and ghetto-licious sandwich with the bologna she bought specifically for this day. She washed out the empty mayonnaise jar in the sink and filled it up with red Kool-Aid. She wrapped the sandwich in a piece of wax paper, grabbed the jar of Kool-Aid, and went and sat on the kitchen chair she'd put on the front porch to sit in while she ate this sandwich. She swallowed the last bite right before she saw the nose of the moving truck rolling up the street. It was the best meal she'd ever eaten at this house. Chapter 1. Yvonne's oldest daughter, Darrell Copeland, sneaked and turned the car radio from her mother's favorite station, the old-school Foxy 107, to her favorite, 102 Jams, in Greensboro, then turned the radio off right before Yvonne walked out of the house.
"You know she's going to turn it right back to her station. She always does."
"Shut up, Denisha," Darrell snapped at her younger sister. Sometimes Denisha acted like her calling in life was to tell and comment on everything. Denisha rolled her eyes at her sister, mumbling,
"You are such a butthead. God don't like ugly. Then he sure don't like you, 'cause whenever I look up the word ugly in the dictionary, all I see is a picture of Darrell Lene Copeland."
"Middle schooler, yo mama,"
Denisha shot back, and then shut up when Yvonne opened the car door and it dawned on her that she was talking about her own mama too.
"Middle schooler,"
Darrell said as she licked her finger and wrote an invisible score in the air. Denisha, an eighth grader, hated that she had to wait another year before she could go to Hillside High School with her older sister. Yvonne slid into the driver's seat, buckled her seatbelt, and turned on the radio. One of her favorite older rap songs, Just Walk It Out, was playing. "East Side, Walk It Out. West Side, Walk It Out." She knew Darrell had rigged the radio and wished something her old school ears couldn't stand to listen to was on, so she could flip the switch on her smarty pants 15-year-old. But she opted for an even better comeuppance for Miss Thang.
"Darrell, you go and sit in the back seat with your sister."
"But Mama, you dropped me off first, so what's your point?"
Yvonne replied, knowing that Darrell was working hard to think of a reason to stay in the front. Darrell got out of the car and went and sat in the back with Denisha, who snickered and then said,
"Mama, Dee is breathing on me and rolling her eyes just 'cause she has to ride in the back seat like she is in middle school."
"Stop breathing on your sister."
"But Mama, I look like a chump sitting back here like this, losing cool points."
"Then get up and get moving and don't miss your bus again," Yvonne told her, not caring if she ever earned a so-called cool point ever again. "And from now on," she continued, "every time your lazy butt misses that bus, you will ride in the back for the entire day, 'cause I get tired of driving you to school when I don't have to."
"I ain't never heard you complain about driving Trog to school, just me."
Darrell snapped at her mother and then rolled her eyes to add to the effect. Yvonne drove back up into the driveway, put the car in park, and got out. She opened the back door and reached for her oldest child. Darrell grabbed the passenger side seatbelt strap in a feeble effort to stay in the safety zone of the car. But when her mother began to climb into that back seat, Darrell started to cry and whimpered.
"I'm sorry, Mama, I didn't mean it. Okay, Mama? Okay, Mama?"
"Darrell, if you ever take a mind to talk like that to me again, you are going to need the SWAT team to get me up off of you. Do you understand me, little girl?"
"Yes, ma'am,"
Darrell said, sheer relief pouring all over her when Yvonne finally retreated from the back seat. Denisha was still and quiet, hoping to fade into the seat upholstery. The last thing she wanted was for her mama to break off a piece of what she was about to put on Darrell and then give it to her. But her plan to remain unnoticed wasn't foolproof. Yvonne's keen mama eyes bore into Denisha with greater precision than any laser.
"And you better watch your step too, Missy. I have plenty left over of what I was planning to give to your sister. Do I make myself clear?"
"Yes, ma'am," Denisha whispered. "Now, let's see if we can do what we've been trying to do all morning. Leave this house and get you two to school," Yvonne snapped, and then turned the radio to the light gospel station. She hiked up the volume on what she secretly knew Darrell and Denisha believed was the countryest gospel song ever written in modern history. She tried not to laugh when she saw the sisters try to sneak and roll their eyes when the words, "Jesus is my doctor, he brings me all my medicines," in the room, blasted out of the car windows for everybody to hear. Darrell started praying under her breath, "Lord, please end this song before we get to the turn light for Hillside." Yvonne waved at Denisha and pulled off from her last school stop, Durham School of the Arts Middle School entrance, and gave a sigh of relief. If those two weren't getting on her last nerve this morning, she didn't know who was. Yet, irrespective of the little Negro cheering show the girls had put on this morning, life was more pleasant and peaceful than it had been in years. And to add to her joy, Yvonne couldn't even describe the relief she'd felt when Darrell called to announce that he was going on an academic sabbatical in Vietnam. 6 whole months without having to lay one eye on Darrell Edward Copeland and his wifey-to-be, Dr. Bettina Davidson, was the best news she'd heard in a very long time. Darrell was pompous and difficult, but that Bettina, the heifer was sneaky, mean, and always trying to take a shot at her sister from somewhere in the cut. 6 whole months without those heathens in her life was enough to make Yvonne want to get out of her car and do the holy dance right out here on Highway 751. Yvonne turned the radio to Foxy 107. An old Keisha Cole song was playing. She turned the radio up so as not to miss one note of one of her favorite songs. "I remember when my heart broke. I remember when I gave up loving you." Yvonne could practically feel those words, sung to such a lovely melody with the smoothest jazz piano solo tinkling in the background. Yvonne remembered the day her heart broke, felt as if it would never be made whole again. She used to wish, in the most painful moments, that there was some kind of crazy glue from heaven she could apply to all of the fragments of her heart and put it back together. And sometimes it seemed as if nobody understood what she was going through. It was in those moments of the worst pain that she realized Jesus understood, and he had everything she needed to put her heart back right. The day she gave up loving Darrell to Jesus was the day Jesus took her heart in his hands and healed her. She was glad to be at a stoplight. It gave her some time to enjoy the beautiful blue sky, made even lovelier by the fluffy white clouds and the warm sunshine bathing her face. It was a wonderful day, and Yvonne was glad that her heart was free and full of joy. Folks just didn't know how heartache and too much struggling could dim even the sunniest day. But to be able to pray those clouds back and bask in God's love was something wonderful, and Yvonne didn't take it for granted. "Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for me," she said out loud, glad the DJ decided to really go old school and do an instant replay of the song. Sometimes you just needed to hear one of your favorite songs more than once. Yvonne knew that God had been so good to her. She had a wonderful home in Cashmere Estates and the perfect job as a designer and adjunct professor in the Department of Interior and Exterior Design at Evangeline T. Marshall University, or EVA T, as the school was called by most black folk in Durham County. Yvonne turned left onto O'Kelly Chapel Road and then turned left again when she reached the entrance of the university, which was located where the Durham and Chatham County lines intersected. She drove down the narrow street leading to the Daniel Meeting Building, where she worked, eyes scanning the area for a parking space. There was a shortage of decent parking spaces on campus, and if that wasn't bad enough, just across the road stood the brand new athletic department with more spaces than they needed or ever used during working hours. She wished somebody could get through to the athletic director, Gilead Jackson, and persuade him to let her department use some of those spaces. But Gilead was the kind of Negro who loved having something other people wanted,
and it made his day every time he stood in his picture window and watched folks from other departments driving around and around the campus looking for a decent place to park. When asked why he was so mean and stingy, Gilead said, "Those parking spaces are mine, and I can do whatever I want to do with them. If I choose to let them sit there empty, then that's just the way it's going to be." The departments in close proximity to the athletic department's parking spaces, like Yvonne's building, decided to go over Gilead's head when he issued that bold, ugly, and callous statement during a faculty senate meeting. But they soon found out that those efforts were in vain because their president, Sam Rettman, was prone to looking the other way when Gilead Jackson was the subject of his faculty's concern. A few folks decided that they would just step up and outbold Gilead and parked in those spaces anyway. That rebellion was quickly put to rest after everybody's car was towed to a barbed wire fenced lot in Chapel Hill with pit bulls running all over the place. The faculty was furious, especially when they heard about those mean guard dogs standing watch over some folks' prized Mercedes and Lexus cars. They threatened Gilead with a boycott of all athletic department activities at the next faculty senate meeting. His response? "This is a historically black institution of higher learning. Do you honestly think that I believe all of you black people are going to give up football, basketball, track and field, tailgating parties, homecoming, butt-jiggling cheerleaders, and the Battle of the Bands competition over some parking spaces? Y'all Negroes best get up on out of my face before I honor my well-earned reputation as a Class A Division I butthead." Yvonne had been at that meeting. She couldn't believe Gilead had gotten up at a university meeting and talked like he was a thug on the corner, getting ready to throw down. But she had to remember that they were at a HBCU, and there were some behind-the-scenes black people shenanigans occurring that boggled the mind and would run a white person crazy. Black people. She loved her people, and she loved and cherished black institutions. But sometimes, black folk were something else. She spied a decent parking space and eased her brand new sea blue, metallic colored Infiniti FX45 SUV into it. Yvonne and the girls loved this car. The day they bought it, they rode all over Durham smiling and laughing, having the time of their lives, and hollering out of the windows at anybody they knew. But this car was just the icing on the cake of the many blessings God had poured into their lives once Yvonne released her old life into his hands and the divorce became final. She had a year-to-year position in the Department of Interior and Exterior Design at a decent salary, along with a lovely 2,100-square-foot cottage for the price of a modest two-bedroom apartment in Cashmere Estates. It was nothing but the Lord who led Lamont Green to lease the home out to her for $850 a month in exchange for her upgrading and designing it for the virtual tour of cottage homes on the community's website. Yvonne also served as the in-house consultant for upgrades and changes to all homes in Cashmere Estates. She got out of the car and went around to the back to get her bag filled with floor samples, paint samples, and swatches of materials for the furnishings needed for the university's newly rehabbed building for the alumni, boosters, and trustees. Yvonne set the bag on the ground, closed the back of the SUV, and headed inside. She set the bag down one more time and was about to pull at the heavy door when her eyes lighted on Tangi Bonner, one of the university's assistant managers for food services, getting out of Rico Sneed's car. Rico was married to her friend Marquita Robinson Sneed and didn't have a semblance of a job at Eva T. If her memory served her correctly, Rico worked at UNC in Chapel Hill. It was almost 9 o'clock in the morning, and if what she knew about most state jobs was correct, old boy should have been on the clock about an hour ago. She watched Tanji leaning down and sticking her head into Rico's window, butt twitching back and forth, like whatever was being said sure was sounding good to her. Yvonne felt a stab of pain in her heart. Marquita was a sweet person and didn't deserve to be disrespected by either of them. Even though Rico had never been one of Yvonne's favorite people, she'd never pegged him to be a liar and a cheat. She always believed that he was a trash-talking and opinionated braggart, but not a cheat, and especially not with a cheap trick like Tanji Bonner. Plus, Tanji should have been ashamed of herself, considering the many times she had been to Marquita's house, soliciting her help with a special catering job at the school that food services wasn't equipped to handle. Not to mention how many times the girl had been at the house stuffing her face with some of Marquita's good food, or bemoaning the loss of one more man who Tanji had previously claimed was the one. And there were absolutely no words to describe a man who would tap some tail off a woman who had been all up in his wife's house. Yvonne could hear Rico laughing and wish she couldn't imagine what that Negro looked like sitting in that red Cadillac STS, grinning and talking trash. Because she knew exactly what he looked like, had seen him countless times whenever they were around Marquita and her family. It was a good thing for those two that Yvonne didn't have her nail gun down in that bag, or else she would have shot out all of Rico's $350 tires. She went into the building, momentarily refreshed by the song playing over the department sound system. Elder Jimmy Hicks's, "I told that old devil to get on out of my way, he's got to move," was playing. Yvonne loved that song. It said exactly what the saints felt when the enemy was standing in the way causing trouble. There were two gospel musicians who could get you going good in the morning, as far as she was concerned. Elder Jimmy Hicks and Keith Wonderboy Johnson. Their earthy down-home songs always told it like it needed to be told. One of the best things about working in this department was that it was staffed by saved, sanctified, and Holy Ghost-filled folk. That was rare. Most times there were a few saved folks in the cut, but never like this. And it was a beautiful thing to work with people who love the Lord and worked hard to live and work in line with the Word of God. Yvonne unlocked the door to her office, which was more like an office/workshop. The room was about the size of a large family room in a good-sized home. The walls were painted a soft and soothing shade of gray, with charcoal on all of the wood trim and molding. Her door was brick red, as were the wooden blinds and her desk and shelves. There were large plants and charcoal in brick-colored pots placed along the windows, which practically surrounded the entire room. Industrial steel lighting hung from the ceiling, and there were two large steel cabinets at the back of the room that were full of rolls of upholstery fabric, area rugs, paint, and a host of interesting tools and items. There were also two ebony-colored wood tables surrounded by brick-stained steel chairs with charcoal and brick-colored tile flooring. Yvonne had decorated her own office, which was the envy of many of her colleagues. She flipped on her computer, typed in the password, and then began her morning ritual of opening the blinds and checking on her plants. The phone rang just as she was about to stick her finger down into the soil of one of the plants. "Do you ever answer your phone on time?" her cousin Maurice's wife, Trina Fountain, asked. "I answered it on time this time," Yvonne responded defensively. "Quit lying," Trina told her. "You know that you got to that phone on time by accident, and you probably wasn't even concerned if you got to it on time or not." Yvonne didn't say anything. Trina was right. She didn't care if she didn't get to the phone on time. All she had to do was check her voicemail and then call whoever it was back. What was so bad about that? "Uh-huh. Your butt always gets quiet when you get called out," Trina told her. "So, are you still coming to the house for dinner this evening?" "I think so," have a lot of work to do today, Yvonne answered. Trina blew air out of her mouth, exasperated. You know something, Yvonne. It's high time you got a life so that you can be out where the right man will be able to find you. He'll find you out there working and having a full life. Well, I am trying to have a full life, but I really don't know what there is that I can do about the man. I mean, if the brother is going to find me, it shouldn't matter what I'm doing. God will help him find me, don't you think? Trina was quiet a moment. Yvonne did have a point. God could do anything. If the Lord decided the man he had for Yvonne was supposed to find her while she was walking through her neighborhood in those old ratty-looking sneakers she loved to wear, that is exactly how the brother would find her. Nonetheless, Yvonne really did need to schedule more time to have fun and be in the mix of things a bit more. As far as Trina could tell, the poor thing didn't even know the art of light flirting. A brother approaching Yvonne better be prepared to get looked at like he was crazy or figure out a way to draw her out into some conversation. But then, she really couldn't fault Yvonne too much on that account. How could she know how to flirt when she'd been married most of her adult life to an old stick in the mud? Plus, the girl had met very few brothers worth her time. And lately, she had been approached by some interesting specimens. Why did the brothers who needed to keep walking always have to be the first ones to get in a sister's face when they discovered that she had been dumped by a man? Did they really think she was so desperate for a man that she was game for an encounter with them? To date, poor Yvonne had been hit on by a permanent part-time security guard at Durham Regional Hospital, who kept his wife safely hidden in South Carolina, a preacher who called her house late in the midnight hour on his way home to his wife, and a broken-down curmudgeon 29 years her senior, who was what Yvonne referred to as just a boll weevil looking for a home. So you're still coming to the house by yourself without the girls to hang out with me and Maurice, right? Yvonne didn't answer Trina, because right now she was absorbed with watching Tangi Bonner and Rico Sneed. That girl was still hanging over in the window of his car. And were they kissing on campus in the daytime, in front of the athletic center of all places? That had to be one of the busiest spots on campus. Yvonne, Trina yelled into the phone. Are you even listening to me? Yes. It's just that I'm standing at this window watching Tangi Bonner and Rico Sneed acting like they go together. Because they go together, Trina told her. I thought you knew that. Tangi's building is very close to yours, and she and Rico haven't been all that discreet. About the only person who doesn't know is poor Marquita. I know I shouldn't say this, but what did she ever see in that dumb think-he-got-game Negro? Yvonne shrugged and then said, I don't know, when she remembered that Trina couldn't see her. Girl, do you know that this trick has some tissue paper hanging right out of her shoes? What kind of Bama mess is that? Are those some yellow pumps? Trina asked. Yvonne pulled the blinds up so she could get a better look at the shoes from her office window. Thank goodness she was on the first floor. Yeah, she does. How'd you know that? 'Cause she had those things on when me and Maurice ran into her trying to act like she wasn't out with Rico when we went to that Jill Scott concert over in Raleigh. I could not believe she was all dressed up on a date with another woman's husband, with some ugly yellow patent leather pumps from the Big Lots clearance bin on her feet. And if that weren't bad enough, the trick had some Kleenex hunched down at the front part of the pump where the top of the tissue was hanging over that hump in the middle of your foot. A hot ghetto mess is what that sounds like, Yvonne said, and then asked, So is yellow now the new black this season? She stared out the window some more. How did you know she got those shoes from Big Lots? Saw them when I was there looking for some inexpensive plant pots. The bin was right next to a row of some pretty pots. Yvonne started laughing. Girl, let me get out of their business, get off this phone, and get some work done so I can relax and enjoy myself at your house tonight. So this means that you're coming, right?
Yes,
Yvonne answered. And Yvonne?
Yes, Trina.
Rochelle is staying with the girls, right?
Yes.
My little sister is staying with the girls. How else will I be able to come by myself? So we're set, right?
Trina asked again. She knew Yvonne, and she knew that girl would start thinking about work and cancel to go off and mix up a special color of paint.
Yes, Trina, Yvonne exclaimed in exasperation. Trina was really working her over about this.
Okay, then, please don't come to my house in your work clothes.
But it's just your house and just you, me, and my cousin. Why would I need to change?
You need to get out of those clothes and into some cute jeans and a top, was all Trina said.
Well, okay. I'll wear some cute jeans and a top to make you happy. Now, can I get myself off of this telephone and get to work?
Bye,
was all Trina said right before she hung up.
Chapter 2. Yvonne spun around in the middle of the kitchen. She said,
So, does this ensemble meet your approval, Mrs. Fountain?
Mm-hmm,
was all Trina said as she dipped several pieces of fresh trout in her special homemade batter and then dropped them into a hot cast iron skillet. It didn't take long for the fish to turn a golden brown, the batter making it all crispy. She turned the fish over and got some more pieces ready to put in the skillet. Yvonne's first cousin, Maurice Fountain, came in from the back, carrying a tray of vegetables he'd just taken off the grill.
What up, cuz? He said, while putting the tray on the counter and then going right back outside.
Hand me that plate with the paper towels on it,
Trina told Yvonne as she started scooping out pieces of trout. She pulled the oven door open and checked on the crispy baked home fries.
Answer the door for me.
The door, Yvonne said. I didn't hear the door.
You hear it now,
was all Trina said when the bell rang again. She hadn't heard it the first time either, just knew that Curtis, who was very prompt, would be at the house about this time.
So are you going to help me out a bit and answer the door?
Yeah, Yvonne said and went up front. Trina just shook her head to herself thinking, the baby is so goofy at times, but that is what makes you love her. She couldn't wait to see Yvonne's face when she came back in the kitchen with Curtis Parker trailing behind her, trying to sneak and look at Yvonne's booty when he knew she wasn't watching him. The doorbell rang a third time and was followed by heavy knocking. Whoever this person was sure did want to get into Trina and Maurice's house awfully bad.
Okay,
Yvonne yelled, before peeking out of a side panel to see who was on the other side. Curtis Parker saw Maurice's cousin peeking at him and wished the girl would open the door. He was hungry and ready to eat. He stared back at her and rang the doorbell one more time for good measure.
Just hold your horses,
Yvonne hollered out and finally opened the door, stepping back almost 3 feet when Curtis Parker stepped inside and got too close for comfort. That good-smelling whiff of his cologne was enough to make her want to move back even more. But she didn't want to appear rude or act as if she found the man offensive in any way. Far from it.
Hold my horses? Been a long time since I've heard that one, girl.
Curtis said, laughing, secretly marveling at how tiny Yvonne Fountain felt standing next to him. He was a very muscular 6'4", which wasn't all that tall by today's basketball standards. He moved a foot closer to where Yvonne was standing. He noticed that she moved some more, so he moved closer to her again, just to get a rise out of her. This was fun. It had been a long time since he'd had that kind of effect on a woman, and he found it refreshing. Yvonne moved some more and smiled up at him, then looked away. What in the world was wrong with her, smiling at Curtis Parker like that? She was a grown woman raising two daughters on her own and should know better than to be grinning up at a man like that. "Trina done with that fish?" Curtis asked, now anxious to get back in the kitchen and get some food in his stomach. It had been a long day, full of meetings and more than enough paperwork. Folks always thought that being the head coach of a basketball team was all about what they saw happening on the court. But that was only a fraction of the job. If he didn't do all of what had to be done behind the scenes, there would be nothing to see on center court. He had to parent, raise money, pay bills, do budgets, train, administrate, recruit, schedule, meet, and advocate. And this often happened before he got to his job description, coach. Yvonne bobbed her head yes and started walking back to the kitchen. Curtis followed behind her at a leisurely pace so that he could enjoy the scenery. Maurice's cousin was fine and putting a hurtin' on those snug-fitting lowriders she was wearing. Few women could look that sexy in a pink T-shirt, blue jeans, and pink Timberlands. That pink was shimmering against Yvonne's cocoa-colored complexion, and those large, round, chocolate diamond-colored eyes sparkled when she flashed that wide, full mouth into a heartwarming smile. Coupled with that firm, round butt, it was enough to make him want to ask the girl if they could go together. Curtis looked at that booty bouncing in those jeans some more. It was taking considerable restraint to resist the urge to pull a quarter out of his pocket and find out just how far it would go after it bounced off Yvonne's behind. Yvonne had the uncomfortable feeling of heat bearing down on her backside and decided to take a seat and get her butt out of the line of fire when she caught Curtis studying her with his head tilted to the side and a crooked grin on his face. Why did this Negro have to be so cute? He was long and muscular, deep dark chocolate like a Mounds candy bar, and had eyes that lit up with merriment when he smiled. She thought his eyes were his best feature. Yet, as cute and engaging as Curtis Parker was, Yvonne had to remember that he had yet to express any kind of interest in turning in his player's card. Plus, he always had some woman hanging on his arm whenever she saw him outside of a basketball game. Come to think of it, this was one of the few times Yvonne had seen Curtis without a woman trying to hang all over him. "My man," Maurice said when he walked through the door with some more grilled vegetables and hush puppies. "Man, did you just take those hush puppies off of the grill?" Curtis asked. "Something Trina tried out on me and it worked. They are very good. You only put them on the grill for about a minute and a half and man." He picked up a fat hush puppy and held it out to Curtis. "Here, taste it." Curtis chewed and then fanned his mouth. "It is good, but hot. I need some water." He picked up a hush puppy and turned toward Yvonne. "Here, baby, taste this." Yvonne held out her hand, but Curtis just walked over and put the hush puppy in her mouth when she opened it to say something back to him. She chewed and then fanned at her mouth. "Whew, this is good, but it is real hot." "Just like me, baby," Curtis said, grinning. "Good, but real hot." Yvonne gulped down some ice water to cool her mouth down and give that Curtis some time to cool down, too. He was just too grown for his own good. Maurice shook his head at his head coach and boss. Curtis was so wrong, and he knew he was being wrong and was enjoying every minute of it. Maurice noticed that Curtis had the exact same expression on his face as the one he had had when one of the players stole the ball during a game and nobody had seen it coming. Maybe that's what his cousin needed, a man who knew what to say to get past what appeared to be an impenetrable wall of protection. But then again, Maurice understood why Yvonne was like that. She hadn't encountered any man worth her time, and didn't have any patience for foolishness from brothers who knew good and well they were of substandard quality where she was concerned. And it wasn't because his cousin was a snob. Far from it. It's just that she deserved better than those rotten scraps he'd seen some brothers have the audacity to throw Yvonne's way. As much as Maurice wanted his cousin to have a man in her life, he knew that this man had to be right. He had to be a brother whose heart and mind were turned toward Jesus. Curtis Parker was the only man who came close to fitting the bill. And even he was short a few credentials, since he needed a serious overhaul where his relationship with Jesus was concerned. Curtis was enjoying messing with Yvonne. She was so sweet and unworldly, and it tickled him that he could get to her with the basic rudiments of flirting. He had grown accustomed to hardened women who fancied themselves to be more cosmopolitan and sophisticated than they were. Women like his latest girlfriend, Regina Young, who was a staff attorney for the university. Yes, Yvonne was definitely a breath of fresh air, even if she was way too tight with Jesus for his taste. Curtis wasn't so sure he'd know what to do with the kind of woman who would tell you that she loved Jesus and you knew that she meant it. Trina put some more fish on a platter, took the home fries out of the oven, and started making a colorful arrangement of the grilled vegetables. She mixed some fresh lime juice, melted butter, and crushed red peppers in a bowl before giving it to her husband. "Baby, go back out and baste the corn." Maurice took the bowl and told Curtis, "Man, grab those cigars laying next to my laptop and come on outside with me." Curtis picked up the cigars and then hesitated for a moment. He was enjoying Yvonne's company and wanted to stay inside with her. Maurice opened the back door. "Come on, man, we can get a few good puffs in before dinner's ready." "Yeah, Curtis," Trina said while making a pitcher of iced tea. "You and Maurice better go outside with those funky-smelling cigars, 'cause I know you don't think that I'm gonna let you sit back and puff on those things in my house. It already smells like trout. What do you want? You want it to end up smelling like butt, too?" "Trina! Don't Trina me, Maurice Lester Fountain. You know good and well that the trout and those cigars will make this house smell like some old wino's butt." Yvonne wrinkled up her nose and pointed toward the back door. She had never had the privilege of being close enough to a wino to get a whiff of stank wino behind. But she'd gotten her fair share of glimpses of the back of some wino's unwashed pants. And she could tell just by looking at the way the pants dropped down past the contours of their behinds that the last thing you wanted your house to smell like was how those pants' seats looked. Chapter 3. Maurice picked up the basting brush and lathered up those ears of corn real good. "Man, that smells good," Curtis said as he cut the end of his cigar and ran it under his nose. "I've been waiting to try one of these." "Me too," was all Maurice said. "Been saving them for the two of us." "Where'd you get these?" "Charles Robinson," Maurice told him. "Charles wanted to thank me for putting in a good word for him with Veronica Washington." "Robert Washington's ex-wife?" "One and the same," Maurice answered and cut off the tip of his cigar. "But why would a big-time player like Charmaine Robinson's brother Charles need you to put in a good word for him with any single woman in Durham County? Rumor has it that he has all of the free booty in the Triangle on lockdown," Curtis said and lit up his cigar. "Plus, isn't Veronica real serious about her relationship with the Lord? Wouldn't think she'd be all that appealing to Charles." "Well, think again," Maurice said and lit his own cigar. "Old boy has it bad for Veronica.
He's been checking her out ever since Robert left Veronica for his woman, Tracy Parsons. But Maurice, Charles owns Rump Shaker's Strip Club.
Gentlemen's Club, Maurice corrected. It's Rump Shaker's Hip Hop Gentlemen's Club.
Okay, Gentlemen's Club, Curtis said.
But every time I've gone there, I always see women strutting their stuff in some stilettos to get some extra tips. And Veronica, on the other hand, owns a public relations firm and represents only Christian writers, actors, and musicians. So Charles doesn't foresee a conflict with those two businesses being at opposite ends of the lightness and darkness scale?
I don't know what he foresees, Curtis. All I know is that he has it bad for Veronica Washington and is glad that her divorce from her knucklehead husband Robert is almost final.
Well, it seems to me, Curtis said, that Charles doesn't have it bad enough to crack open a Bible and look for the sinner's prayer in Romans.
Now, is this a case of the pot calling the kettle black?
Maurice chided Curtis before taking a puff on his cigar. Curtis frowned. Maurice didn't have to go there. Maurice knew that he had said the sinner's prayer many years ago. As if reading his mind, Maurice said, "You said the sinner's prayer and have been on milk ever since." He didn't care one bit that Curtis didn't want to hear this. Too bad. But Curtis had yet to be weaned off of spiritual milk long enough to have a hunger for the bread of heaven.
"Okay," Curtis conceded, when it was clear that Maurice wasn't going to back down on this one. "I could do better about reading my Bible."
"Just your Bible, dog?"
Maurice asked him. "Seems to me like you need a complete overhaul where your relationship with the Lord is concerned."
"Charles Robinson and me too, huh?"
"Well, actually, Curtis, you are a couple of steps ahead of Charles Robinson. You may be on some milk, but that boy can only take a few ounces of formula right now."
Curtis started laughing. Maurice was right. Charles owned the premier exotic dancers establishment in the Triangle. He was making money like it was really growing on trees. That was a lot of money because trees and forest land were plentiful in Durham County. Dense, uncultivated land was everywhere, even in the hood. He imagined that it would take a miracle to convince somebody like Charles Robinson to let go of all of his worldly goods, to go off and follow Jesus. Because truth was, running Rump Shaker's Gentleman's Club and living boldly for Christ wasn't going to work. But then again, maybe someone who was as anchored in Christ as Veronica Washington was the perfect incentive to make Charles think long and hard about the benefits of serving the Lord. There was nothing like a saved, Holy Ghost-filled woman, who was also fine, to get a brother to thinking about the potential benefits of turning his life over to Christ. Some folks might not think that that was the best way to find your way to Jesus, but for men like Charles Robinson and himself, it could possibly be one of the most compelling reasons. Curtis almost stopped breathing when it occurred to him the path this kind of thinking was leading him down, because like it or not, he was only a few yards shy of his very own prototype of a Veronica Washington. There was no denying it. Both Yvonne and Veronica were some seriously for show Proverbs 31 sisters. A brother couldn't find anything more old school than a woman replete with virtues that were outlined in the Old Testament. Yvonne opened the refrigerator and took out a bowl of olive-green scuppernong grapes. She loved these wild grapes, which were native to North Carolina, and tasted like you were getting a squirt of some homemade wine when you took a bite out of one. She tried her best to sneak a peek on the deck to see what Curtis was doing without being noticed by Trina, who rarely missed a thing. When she caught Trina watching her intently, Yvonne popped a grape into her mouth and then mumbled, "I'll be glad when dinner is ready, 'cause I'm hungry." Trina just looked at Yvonne trying to be slick and on the low,
trying to watch Curtis and act like he wasn't getting next to her.
Huh, Trina thought, and then whispered to herself. Rochelle was right when she said that there ain't nothing like a new Negro to inspire you in all the right ways to get over and done with the old Negro.
You say something, Trina?
Not really, just thinking out loud. And speaking of thoughts, I didn't miss that little sniff and inhale number you were doing when Curtis walked past you.
Yvonne couldn't believe Trina had seen that. She was almost as bad as Rochelle. But she couldn't help it. Curtis was wearing Chanel for Men, and it smelled good on him.
Oh, snap, Trina said, grinning. Miss Thangy Thang got a little crushy crush on the coach. Who would have thunk it? Sweet little Yvonne Fountain sniffing and inhaling on the big bag Curtis Parker.
Shut up, Trina, Yvonne hissed, hoping she wasn't blushing, even though her cheeks were warm and getting warmer by the second. She hoped that Curtis would stay outside for a few more minutes and wished that he'd bring his butt back in the house. Last thing she needed was for a skilled player like Curtis to discover that she was blushing and sniffing up on his cologne.
Girl, take a chill pill, Trina told her, hoping that the men would hurry up and finish with those cigars to come back in and hang out with them.
Curtis, of all people, needed to relax with some good company, especially the company of a good woman like Yvonne. As far as Trina was concerned, Curtis spent too much of his precious time boo-boo kiddying with the wrong kind of women. And maybe they weren't just the wrong kind of women. Perhaps they were the worst kind of women. Ironically, not a one of Curtis's women could technically be branded as a skank, hoochie, scoochie, or even a skeezer. If only it were that easy. No, these sisters were those well-dressed, educated, stuck-up old sticks in the mud who thought more highly of themselves than they should. They were like those dry clouds Jesus accused the Pharisees of being. So many promises, so little action, so empty and dry and useless, their very presence a sin and a shame. Trina believed that Yvonne was a blessing waiting to happen as far as Curtis was concerned. It was pretty clear that Curtis thought the girl was fine, not to mention the way he smiled and chuckled at just about everything that little Negro had said so far this evening. Every time Miss Yvonne said a little quip about something, all she heard from Coach was, ha 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 ha. Yvonne was funny, but that Negro wasn't that funny. Curtis Parker wasn't the only one who was thunderstruck. Yvonne was just as taken with him as he with her. But Yvonne was in the hole with regard to cool points, so she was working overtime to try and hide her attraction to him. Trina knew the girl would rather die 1,000 horrible deaths in consecutive order than have Curtis discover he was getting next to her. Yet, the best thing that could happen to Yvonne was for Curtis to be an eyewitness to the beautiful ruby blush that spread across her cocoa-colored cheeks, lighting up those sparkling chocolate diamond-colored eyes, simply because of the sparks bouncing back and forth between the two of them. It was time for Yvonne to have a good, handsome, and decent man to take notice of and appreciate her. When Yvonne was married to Daryl, she worked overtime to get along with that boy and keep the marriage intact. It was amazing. Daryl had earned a PhD in biology from Stanford University, and yet he acted as if he were mentally challenged whenever Yvonne tried to talk to him about the problems in their marriage. No matter what she said and how she said it, Daryl just didn't get it. Daryl didn't want to understand that it was inappropriate for a woman from his department to call his house and hang up whenever Yvonne answered the phone. He didn't get it when Yvonne told him that Bettina was rude and nasty whenever she came to the house, and that perhaps he needed to get her straight. Yvonne had tried and tried to explain, petition, and help Daryl understand the problem, but always to no avail.
It was as if she had been speaking a remote foreign language. But once Yvonne rededicated her life to the Lord, went back to her home church, Fayetteville Street Gospel United Church, and dived headfirst into the Word of God, she told Trina that the Lord blessed her with an answer to that problem. It had been on one of those hard nights, the ones when the reality of being divorced got to you. Yvonne was on her knees doing a bang-up job with the divorce thing, crying uncontrollably, hollering, flinging snot, hanging all on the bedpost, calling out, "Why, God, why?" in that raspy, gravelly, annoying, pity-party, crying voice. She was on a roll with that thing and threw in some real good, desperate, and pitiful-sounding, "Why me? What's wrong with me, Jesus? Why you let this happen?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.